Bibles, the book of Psalms. And before we get to that, I wanted to meet our guests, and I missed any visitors earlier. And we got our ushers out taking care of the offering here. But let's see if somebody back there is smart enough to find a visitor's card or two for me. But if you're brand new tonight or you brought a guest, we'd like to at least get a visitor's card to you. So if you're here for the first time or you brought a visitor, anybody brand new tonight? I got off thinking about people that are sick. All right, got the faithful same group here. We're always glad to have visitors. All right, Proverbs in chapter 1 and Psalms 111. Psalms 111. Psalms is right before the book of Proverbs. And this month, during the month of January, first month of the year, we'll read Psalms 111 first, then we'll go to Proverbs. In this first month of the year, we have a little bit of a theme that we're following on reaching the next generation, knowing how to pass the baton. We had five young men who were teenagers in our church, grew up here, who are now either pastoring or an assistant pastor, had them fill in the pulpits the last Wednesday in December, and then four services in a row here in January. And I just don't know if any of us realize how good it is that God has blessed us with fruit that remains. Jesus said in John 15, "And this is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit, and that your fruit should remain." God, with a big day that the Marcos had, if you weren't here Sunday, we showed pictures from the third anniversary from, I don't know, whatever anniversary it was, third or fourth, Doug Marco and David Tuzak, and they dedicated their new auditorium, they dedicated it to Brother Tuzak, and they're from our church, if you don't know them, but had a huge day, almost 800 people, and that's great, big day, people being saved. But the thing that really brings glory to God and honors God is when we train people to keep on going for God. Because if people don't keep going, then it drops the ball. It's like what happens in America. If we forget we're a constitutional republic, if we forget that we are a people ruled by founding documents, not by the whims of popular opinion, it really doesn't matter what popular opinion is. What judges are supposed to do is to protect the constitutionally guaranteed rights of people, and public opinion is of absolutely no importance if it goes contrary to the laws that were set up in our country. And but see, that's got to be passed down from generation to generation, or we lose it. And especially as we get more of a welfare mentality, an I deserve it mentality, I didn't get my way, so I'm going to scream and cry and hurt somebody mentality, that's craziness. Or I heard today, I don't know this, you heard it on the news, you don't know what it is, but allegedly heard somebody set themselves on fire outside one of the Trump hotels just to protest Trump being president. I thought, yeah, that's a special kind of stupid. And I don't want to be hateful, but if all the people that think like that would do something similar, it would be terrible. And I wouldn't want that to happen. Yeah, I don't know, lock those, heal him, get him well, then put him away somewhere. He should not have a firearm. He should not have fire. But we're in a world, if a two-year-old can scream and throw a fit and have a temper tantrum, what do they do when they're 14? And what do they do when they're 40? And what do they do when their candidate doesn't win? And what a mess we can be in our country, passing down principles of family, principles of country, principles of loyalty, principles of hard work, principles of honesty and integrity. And you that are younger, you don't understand this, but we're just 30, 40, well, closer to 50 years away from a generation where a man's handshake, it was law. And you didn't need a contract. Contracts were invented because of attorneys and a bunch of crooks. We were, just when I was a child, Bibles were read in schools, Pledge of Allegiance in the schools, a loyalty, respect for the flag and for the military, and something happened, and I've got ideas, but I don't know, obviously, but something turned the corner, and we had the drugs, the abortion, the Haight-Ashbury crowd, the rebellion during the Vietnam War. We had that whole window, something dramatically turned. The Bible was taken out of our schools, prayer out of our schools. Dr. Spock's book went wild in America on why you shouldn't spank your rampant across America, and then that group of people are the ones who now run our country, and it's no wonder they're a bunch of idiots. And tonight, talking about passing what we believe on to the next generation, I want to talk just about education tonight. Our theme, the three areas this month, are Christian education, bus ministry, and the youth ministry. Because if we have the Sunday school right, and if we have the day school, the Monday through Friday school right, and then if we have our bus ministry and our outreach to children right, we will pass something on to the next generation. And the Christian home is obviously huge in that, as you'll see tonight in the Bible study. But let's make this clear in our minds, if we don't have our churches right, we're in trouble. God instituted the home, and the home is key, but if we don't have good schools, and we don't have good churches, and we don't have good youth departments, mom and dad have the kids, but who's got them the 160 hours a week they're away at school, and sports, and all that kind of thing? And if we're going to raise a generation, and let me just go back where I started. We had these five young men preach for us when I was gone. We have the fruit here all over the room tonight. There are adults who were teenagers in our church. We've got teenagers in our church whose parents were teenagers in our church. And obviously we don't bat 1,000 because we're flesh and the pastor's a sinner as the parents are, and we're weak. But we have an amazing track record of God's mercy and blessing. And if I were to start having children, which we are not even going to consider that, I would want them right here. I'd want them in our youth department, our Sunday school. I'd want them in a part of this whole thing. And so tonight, I want to talk a little bit on school. And I know some of you don't have children, but I'll explain how this applies to you as well. So let's look at Psalms chapter 111. Psalms 111. And look at the last verse in Psalms 111. Psalms 111, verse 10. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. A good understanding have all they that do his commandments. His praise endureth forever. Several quick principles. First of all, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Before you get to kindergarten in wisdom, you must understand the fear of God. It's got to start there. That's the beginning of everything. And so if we want a young person to grow up with any measure of wisdom, they have to grow up with the fear of God. You cannot take a young person and alienate them from God and the Bible and expect to raise a generation of wise adults. It's not going to happen. Second statement there, and we got a lot of territory to cover. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Then a good understanding of all they that do his commandments. Of course, we want our young people to have wisdom. We want them to have understanding. Wisdom is the ability to see the end result of a given action. And it's that thinking about doing it, realizing what will happen if I do it, or potentially could happen, and then making your determination on the action on the basis of the end result or what God would think of it, and then you decide. That's wisdom. Understanding is dealing with the day-to-day affairs of life. It's how to handle a customer. It's how to handle somebody. Today I went to a store and all their electricity was out. They, for some reason, the credit card machine worked, but I don't know if it was just their cash register or whatever. And I was so impressed. I had a couple of items that were not taxable, a couple of items that were taxable, and the girl had a little tiny calculator and a pad of paper, and she figured it out. I thought, give her a raise. I just was shocked. And there was a gal there, an older gal that maybe was the owner, and the girl asked her one question about what is taxable and what wasn't. And the older lady looked at me, and she was older. I am not older. This thing is older. And she said, she's having to go back to our days when we knew how to write and do figures in our head. And I said, don't say our day, old lady. But she was probably 61 or something. But understanding, the ability to see and to think and to understand things. We're such an inept society that can't figure out. I mean, we've got a world of people who can't figure out how to change a belt in a vacuum cleaner, or worse yet, how to use a vacuum cleaner. We're crazy. How do you do dishes and how do you cook? And just yesterday, I'm driving down the road, had some news on the radio, and somebody's advertising whatever. You can get these meals, healthy meals, delivered to your home, and they're ready to go for right around $10 a meal per person. I'm thinking, why you can feed a whole family for $10? What are you thinking? What kind of loser daughters are we raising that don't know how to cook? Amen? You got a daughter, she needs to learn how to cook. I mean, look, you boys, let me just tell you this. If she can't cook biscuits and cookies, don't even have the first date. And then future dates are dependent on her ability to mature your waistline. And let's be honest, I tell these Spanish girls, you are betraying your race if you don't know how to make tamales. You Filipino girls, if you don't know how to make lumpia and panza and all that good stuff, don't even call yourself a Filipina. You're a traitor to your gender and your culture. Don't lose. By the way, that's passing down what we are. This is Goddardism. I think you ought to keep your native language. I think you ought to speak English. Amen. Everybody ought to speak English if you're going to live here. But why not keep touch with your? It gives you another language to witness in. And you're going to meet people. And my family's Norwegian. I'll spend my whole life and never meet anyone that speaks Norwegian, so I don't really care. Kelly Talbot goes to our church. She speaks Norwegian. That's one in 60 years of life. But Spanish especially, and many, many Filipino immigrants, that's my opinion. But I know this, we need to have understanding, the ability to figure things out, to not be intimidated by things. We might call that, in a rough sense of the term, horse sense. The fear of the Lord, that gets you wisdom. A good understanding, where do you get a good understanding? Have all they that do his commandments. Now, how can we do commandments we don't have? You take the Bible out of kids' lives, and you drop them in an atheistic school that denies God and denies creation and denies the Bible. No wonder we've got a generation of idiots. We've taught them since the mid-1960s that they evolved and they're nothing more than a glorified animal. And so we've got tree worshipers and bug worshipers and fairy shrimp worshipers and people that'll abort their baby while they save a stray dog. And no offense, I like dogs, I like cats, but you know what? When they're dead, they're dead. They're just a pile of carbon. There's nothing to them. Humans have a soul. Animals don't have an eternal soul. And you are eternal, and this world is crazy. I showed the young people in one of the classes in the Christian school yesterday a video where they surveyed college students and young adults. There's a person you don't know drowning and your dog that you do know drowning. Which one do you save? Two-thirds said they would not choose the person. Part of them said, I don't know, and the other part said they'd save the dog. Now that shows this, that's the success of a godless educational system. That's what happens when you send your kids to play soccer on Sunday morning instead of Sunday school. And we can't go there. So the good understanding have all they that do his commandments. So we need the fear of the Lord. We need to do his commandments. Those are things that help us develop the real life. Look over to Proverbs chapter 1. And I'm going to give you a list of about seven things here once we get the scriptures laid out here, but Proverbs chapter 1 almost mirrors Psalm 110. Proverbs chapter 1, and if I get my glass, I'll find it quicker. Proverbs chapter 1, look down at verse 7. Many of you have memorized it. It would be good to memorize these. Proverbs chapter 1, verse 7. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of what? Knowledge. But fools despise wisdom and instruction. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. If you want your child to gain any knowledge worth having in life, it must begin with the fear of God. And don't let anybody tell you it's reverential trust. That word fear means scared to death. David said he feared God and his knees trembled. That's not a reverential trust. That's fear like dad's coming home and you broke something. You know, you and your brother were horsing around in the house and you know there will be a funeral for one or both of you. And you know, unless you have a big dog, you can't blame it on these little things that they're not real dogs. it's an advantage of having a big dog. You can blame it. You're in good shape, Rita. Your dogs can, and your sister. You girls have real dogs. They can tear the house up. The kids can lie easily. The dog did it, Mom. But the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. If we don't have a fear of God, we're not going to learn the most basic principles of knowledge. Now, that may or may not make sense to us, but it's what God said. And we have a culture that doesn't understand loyalty. And again, I'm not saying I have all the understanding in politics, but I really do think we need to bring back treason and the punishment for treason. And I think a Secretary of State and a President both ought to be tried. We're in a mess. When you can do harm to your country and be in a position of respect and honor and influence and betray your nation, that's treason. And ought to be treated by hanging publicly right in the center of the Washington Square, right next to the Washington Monument. You say, oh, that'd be horrible. Well, back in the days they did that, people feared doing wrong. What's there to fear when you don't get punished? And so the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction. The idea that people despise the Bible, they reject the Bible, they want nothing to do with the Bible, that proves they're fools. So we take our children, the most precious possession we have, and from 7:30 or 8 on Monday morning till 3 or so in the afternoon, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, 30 hours or so a week, we put our most precious possessions at their age of learning, the age their minds and their morals and their ethics are all developing, and we dump them at the feet of the heathen, according to Proverbs 1, who are fools. Because anybody who despises wisdom and instruction, they're a fool. And if I had, it was interesting, sitting with Rose Culpepper here, her husband right at death's door, and she says, Pastor, you know what I've been praying? She said, I've been praying that God would help me be able to start a nonprofit organization where I could make enough money to put all the children who ride our buses into a Christian school. A good lady. In the midst of her grief, she says, for 2 years she's been praying about it. She wants to find a way to get our kids into Christian school, and I'd like to get them to Bible college and have scholarships for young people. She understands the value of wisdom and instruction. So if we don't get our kids to have the fear of God, they cannot have the beginning of knowledge. Proverbs 9, just turn over a couple of pages. Proverbs chapter 9, verse 10, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Proverbs chapter 9, verse 10, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the holy is understanding. If we want our children to have understanding, they need to have the knowledge of the holy, of God being the holy proper, but of those things which are holy. Now, I've got a problem with TV. Most of you know that. But here you have hired prostitutes, which are prostitutes, I guess they're all hired. A woman who is involved intimately with someone for cash is a whore. Okay? And it doesn't matter if she's alone with the person paying her, or if she's in front of 10 cameras, a producer, a director, and 30 other people, and 50 million viewers. She's still flesh for sale. She's not a movie star. You see, the knowledge of the holy is understanding. We can't park our children over in front of that kind of smut and expect our children to have understanding. We've got to be able to shut that television off. And I will step on the sacred cow of athletic cheerleaders. You can't go there. You know, some people say, why don't we have cheerleaders? Because I'm not really ready to fight that battle. Been here 35 years. We've had school sports for 25 or 20 of those years. And as soon as I'm dead, you can have cheerleaders. It's a hard battle to fight to keep cheerleaders godly. It just is. And ask any school that has them, they'll tell you it is a constant battle. And I don't think it's wrong. I thank God for people who do it, but I'm not going there. There are just things to see, a knowledge of holiness, but specifically a knowledge of the holy, that the holiness of God and the whole, we have so forgotten the word holy. The actual word holy is sanctify, to set apart. The word sanctify means to set apart from wrong and set apart unto right. That's the word holiness. And when we separate our lives and separate our children from that which is unholy, they gain understanding. And there are things that as you get older that might not bother you. But we, you know, a 10-year-old, they're a blank slate. A 14-year-old, a 16-year-old, there are things they shouldn't hear, things they shouldn't see. And it's huge, it's huge. Let me just give you quickly 5 or 6, 7, 8, whatever time we have, things about this matter of training our children specifically in regard to education. A gymnasium does not, I'm for a gym, and this, the next building we're supposed to be building out here is a multi-purpose room. It'll seat 800, 900 people, and it will be a gym, and it'll be wedding receptions. It'll be a whole lot of things, but a gym doesn't make for a good education. The more money, America throws more money at our schools than just about any other country in the world, while we continue to be 20 or 30 down in our academic performance of training our young people. We are not succeeding educationally in America. Now, private schools are, and again, pray about our administration and pray about the appointments, because if you let the windows and the doors open to private education, and however parents have the choice of where their taxpayer money goes, you are going to see public schools completely vanish, because no one really wants their kids in there, let alone the public school teachers. You know, the Obamas didn't send their kids to a public school. And most of our, you know, it's interesting, you go to, the politicians are an aloof, elite group of people. This of the people, by the people, for the people thing, that is all nonsense. They don't understand what Abraham Lincoln meant when he said that. But all of the gun laws they voted into California, they exempted the California legislature. Now, at that point, I think we just need to go up and beat them. I'm not inciting a riot, I'm joking, but I think it would be good if we could. It's not lawful, but if they made a law that you can, I would be there. But it's not lawful, and I would keep the law, and I would do no harm to anybody unjustly or inappropriately. But you know the government doesn't, they're not in Social Security. Now you all have to be in Social Security. But our politicians are. Most of our government employees, I'm not going to say universally, I don't understand all of it. I know when I worked with the Forest Service, I was amazed that the Forest Service had their own retirement program, and it was very carefully funded and cared for and nurtured, while Social Security is a wreck. But we're a mess. Knowledge and wisdom are vacant. But this idea that throwing money at an institution make it be more, make people learn. Money doesn't make people teach. Well, I remember years ago, we had just started our school, maybe four years in our school, and there was a representative of the curriculum that we used, and he would just go school to school, just checking up. Do you need anything? Can we help with anything? And he wasn't an inspector, because he came in one day and with the attitude, if he's coming to check out our school, I said, I'll throw you off our property. Our school is private, it's personal, and you got no business on our property. He said, whoa, I just, that's not a good term. I'm here to see if I can help you in any way. And I really have a capital I on this independent thing. And we don't need an outsider telling us how to raise our children. And we can mess them up on our own. But he became a friend of ours. And he went to schools all over the southwestern United States. We were in a double-wide trailer with a dirt parking lot and a tent for our auditorium and our, you know, school programs. Our playground was the dirt, and the kids kicked the ball against the side of the trailer. He said, you may have the most productive, academically and socially and spiritually, the most productive. productive school of any that I know of. We didn't have a basketball group. We didn't have an athletic program. For PE, I'd take the kids, or one of us would take the kids over to a park. And I remember playing soccer with some of the kids. And we'd put the girls on that side of the field, boys on this side of the field, offense, defense on each side. I remember one of the girls kicking the ball, Irene Howard Foster, kicking the soccer ball, hitting one of our adult men right in the jaw with the ball, dislocated his jaw. It was great. That's why we don't play mixed sports here. It's embarrassing when the girls hurt you. But it's not about money. Several things. I'm going to give you just a list of things here for a better education. Brother Beal is going to have him talk about this some, but he and I didn't get together and I was running too much today. Number one, you're not going to believe this. Get your kids some sleep. It's really hard to keep a kid's attention when they're dozing off in class. And I teach in school a couple of classes each semester. One semester I teach one class, next semester I teach two classes, back and forth. We have kids that can't stay awake in class. They got to sleep. Kids need sleep. And honestly, my children need more sleep than I do. I run on almost no sleep. It's not a big deal. But kids need sleep. Number two, get rid of the junk food. Kids need to eat decent. And I'm not a no ice cream, no candy person. Guarantee you, we have a plate of brownies on the counter at home. I'm not an abstain from all healthy junk food. I'm just saying eat some decent things. Look, you older teenagers and you young adults, you can't live on energy drinks. It's not good for you. You need peanut butter sandwiches or something, all right? But I know that's getting personal. Get your kids to bed. Get them some decent food. Go low on the sugar. Look, everybody knows sugar's not a help. It just isn't. As good as it tastes, it's not a help. I will say this, when we were in Israel, just in February, we start our Sunday school lessons. I'll show you some videos of Israel. I don't want to bore people with Israel, but one tidbit in Israel, kosher food doesn't allow dairy products and meat in the same room. So at dinner, we have, five different kinds of meat at dinner, and vegetables and a huge salad bar, and the most amazing dessert buffet. You walk over there, it just makes you drool. Gourmet desserts, all made without butter, without milk and without cream, because there's meat in the room. Could I tell you, dessert without milk, butter, and cream is just about worthless. You just well chew on a candle. It looks pretty, but it doesn't. You ever try eating a wax grape, you know, out of your grandma's fruit bowl? It's just terrible. And if you want to know the biblical basis for no dairy and no meat, I mentioned this to some people, it's you can't boil a calf in its mother's milk. That's the priest's and the rabbi's interpretation. And that's why much learning doth make you mad. And verse got nothing to do with cheese on your bacon cheeseburger. Which they had no pork there either, which is a sad thing. All right, so number one, some sleep. Number two, get your diet. I don't want to insult anybody, but if you have to buy pre-made pancakes and you can't figure out how to make a pancake, please have somebody raise you over again or something. My goodness. Pancakes and scrambled. Breakfast is the easiest meal. Every child should be able to cook their own breakfast from anyway. Cooking. You know, cooking, you ought to be able to cook. Your boys ought to be able to cook. Certainly your girls ought to be able to cook. Anyway, I don't know. All right, let's get off the personal issues. Number three, the parents ought to be involved in the academics. You ask any teacher, how can I teach your child when you are not involved? I mean, being involved meaning go to the parent-teacher meetings, hang around the school, look at the books your child is reading. Your child, when we do book reports, Brother Beal, correct me if I'm wrong, don't the parents have to approve the books the kids read for book reports or something like that? Mrs. Bailey's not here. I was going to ask her. I remember signing statements. Yes, this book is okay. And I'm assuming they still do this. We want you involved. Is that right, parents? Some of you parents know what I'm talking about. I see some heads nodding. You need to be involved. You should be involved in your kid's life. And And the idea of putting your kid in a public school with unsafe teachers and unsafe administration, a satanic system. Now, there's some great teachers in the public school system, but the system is so godless. And then to have your kid just read any communist thing, any anti-American thing, any socialist thing, any immoral thing, anti-God, pro-Islamic, we're crazy. Get involved in your child's academics. Number four, probably the most important thing you can do for the education of your children is good discipline at home. If you cannot discipline a child, you cannot teach that child. A child that cannot do what they're told can't be taught. And let's just be honest, that two-year-old, that three-year-old, that four-year-old, pretty soon they're going to be in Mrs. Beal's kindergarten class. And she's going to have them in shackles. She's going to duct tape them to the wall. You can't teach. I was a little worried about Josiah, our youngest. I thought, oh, Lord, Mrs. Beal's going to kill him. He was good, but he couldn't sit still. And he wiggled. I mean, he definitely had a case of wiggle worms in some, anyway. He was our humbling child, you know, anyway. But he made it. He's okay. He's a good kid in college. I don't know how he's doing in college, but. If you say to your child, stop, and they don't, you got to work on it. And I mean if they're a year old. I don't mean 12. I mean 6, 8 months. By the time, ladies, listen, by the time that baby can reach for your earring, they cannot reach for your earring. Now, you're holding them like this, and they're this close to that pretty thing there. They're going to grab it. And that's what your fingernail's for, and you flick their knuckles. No. You know, I'm just going to go a year with no earrings. No, train your child. Your kid's pawing at your glasses. Slap their hand. Enough to beat your child. Slap their hand, just flick their knuckles and say no. If every time they hear the word harshly spoken no, they feel pain on their knuckles, you know, they start to reach it. No. It doesn't take long. And then you're in the grocery store and they reach for something on the counter, you say no, and their hand jerks back. You don't have to beat your kid in the store, beat them at home. And I don't believe in beating them. I mean, just a flick to the finger. You don't have to be mean. Your glasses, ladies, your necklace, earrings. I see moms dismembered by their babies. Ladies, get a grip on that child. You know what I'm talking about. Some of you, you've had your earrings torn out by your baby. Discipline. You want to educate your child, you must discipline that child. And a child that cannot be taught to sit, to stand, to be quiet, and to obey is a child that will struggle in school all of their life. Now we need mom and dad both involved in the child's life. The teacher cannot do it on their own. Our school has the most amazing results. 98% of our young people stay in church, and 96% of them go off to college at least for a year or two. And I mean, the percentage of our young people that work and have good jobs is off the charts. But that's not the school, that's home. And the teachers just polish it, and the youth department polishes it. And God, of course, in his mercy, does a lot of work, but we gotta have good homes. And you know, if you're a single parent, get them around everybody you can that'll help them. But we've got to have, we have to have discipline at home. A child should do what they're told, period. And dads, it's not all mom. You need to be involved in this. And dad and mom both, and back each other. This is not a child-rearing lesson, but back each other. If mom's starting to do some correctional whatever, and dad's, oh no, don't do, they're just children. You are gonna blow this thing away. Back the badge. Whoever's the authority at the given time, back them. Somebody comes to my office, a young person, a young adult comes to my office, a college student, preacher, what do you think about? One of my first questions will be, what do your parents think? I will back mom and dad. A wise mom and dad will say, what do you think the pastor thinks? And let's get him involved. Parents have a perspective I don't, I have a perspective they don't. God gives us leaders for a reason. Mom, let me just say this, mom at home, greatest gift. You you can give your child. A mom at home. A mom at home, period. But a mom at home is an incredible asset to your child's education. In our culture, it's difficult to pay all the bills without mom working. I would work as little as possible. I would get rid of where we live and move into some trailer somewhere out in the middle of the, I don't know where, in the desert somewhere. But mom is vital to a child's upbringing. Absolutely vital. This is us, but I wouldn't let, it's not like I'm the boss, but I am. But Mrs. Goddard and I decided she's not going to work until our kids were in school. And when they were out of school, she would be home. And that was just a line we drew. She's always worked a little bit here and there. But man, mother, wife and mother are the two highest callings of any lady. And every girl, I mean little girl, should grow up being taught that. They should know that. They should know there's nothing more important than mother. And nobody knows what makes things tick in a church like ours. But the success we've had is probably a combination of all this. But I know one, I've spent 35 years telling moms, stay home, love your husband, train your children. You look at Timothy, where Paul talks about Adam sinned and willfully with the forbidden fruit, and the wife was deceived, and it says, nevertheless, she shall be saved in childbearing if they continue in faith and charity. That saved, not mean born again, saved. She forfeited her position before God when she gave in to satanic instruction, but she can redeem her relationship and her standing and her importance if she can get her children to honor God. And mama's maybe the most important person in a child's life. Kids need mom. Kids need someone to talk to. When a teenager, and people say, well, when the kids are little, mom's home when they're teenagers. Teenagers are dumb as dirt. Emotional basket cases. Tell me, 12, 13, 14-year-old girl coming home from school, how many days a week does she cry? Over nothing. And then something goes wrong. And the boy she likes talks to another girl. And she needs mom there. She doesn't need dad. Dad's going to say, what's wrong with you? Mom that's never home struggles. Child discipline because she feels guilty because she's never home. Mom who works all the time tends to spoil the child with nice things to soothe her conscience for not being there. And so not only is she not as strong on discipline because she says, well, I'm not a very good mother. Hey, if you're not there, the kid still ought to do right. If you're the single mom and you're having to work a lot, or the job situation where you got to work a lot, you just have to work harder at being mean. Mean moms are just a gift from God. Mine's sitting right over there. I grew up with a mean mom. She would cold cock you in a heartbeat. And I married a mean mom. She wasn't a mom when I married her, but she became a mean mom. And so moms tend to not discipline as strong. And then, and look, this is, I'm just trying to teach you and help you here, okay? I'm not mad at anybody, but it's a help. And then they tend to spoil people, giving them things. And it's so dangerous. Things don't make a good child. Love and discipline and godliness helps. And then I can say this, dad involved. Look how many times in the book of Proverbs it says, my son, my son, my son, my son. There is not a my son from the mother until chapter 30. Outline the whole book of Proverbs on the my son, and then mom comes along and says, my son, give not thy, and then she starts telling the son what to do. And the mom put in her 2 cents. She listened to her husband and said, you missed that. All right, now I'm going to tell you. But she let her husband say have his peace. Might have been after he went to work, I don't know. But the last end of Proverbs, the mom's letting the boy have it. Give not thy strength unto women, nor thy way to that which destroyeth kings, and on and on. Deuteronomy chapter 6 tells the dads, this book of the law shall not do. He says, this book shall be in thy heart, and thou shalt talk about it when you lie down, when you rise up, when you walk in the way. That's a dad chapter. And he says, when you go into the land of Canaan, dads, you talk about the word of God. You teach the word of God. You talk to your children about it. You train your children. Next, discipline. Like I said before, is perhaps the most important thing in education, both at home and the classroom. Therefore, back to teacher. Is the teacher always right? Nope, neither is the mom and dad. But the teacher better back the parents. And the parents need to back the teacher, and the parents need to back. This is just being very honest. My wife and I have had a kid come home from school, tell us a scenario, homework, whatever, how something was handled. And we said, well, whatever the teacher says is right. Go on, do your homework. And we go in our room, close the door, and say, what are they thinking? Call the teacher. And the teacher might have made a mistake. And the teacher might have had a bad day. Or maybe mom and dad don't have as right a perspective. Look, we're all in this together. Understand this here. You that have your kids in our school, you that are going to have your kids in our school, we're like this all the time. You coach my child. I teach your child math. And my wife teaches your child in Sunday school, and your husband teaches my teenager in the youth department or Baptist boys. And we're going to mesh here all the time. We've got to back each other. And if you have a problem, call each other. We're friends. Maybe the two hardest jobs in our church is the nursery superintendent and the school principal. Because here Brother Beal's teaching an adult Sunday school class while he's expelling their children from the school. That's why he doesn't expel kids anymore. The deacon board does. And don't forget deacons. We have a deacon meeting Saturday night, 7:30. We're not expelling anybody. 7 o'clock. I'm sorry. 7 o'clock Saturday. Quickly. Back the authority. By the way, back the coach. Back the police. Back the president. I as little as I like President Obama, if he walked in here tonight, he would be treated with the utmost respect and dignity because of his office. As soon as he's out, man. I'm joking. Next, it has been proven by secular educators that reading to your child will change your child's educational success. Many, many years ago, 32 years ago, I read a survey out of USC, a study they did. These parents read to their child an hour a day, 4 15 minutes, 2 30 minutes, or 1 solid hour, and kept them out of school till they were second grade. This group kept them out of school till they were in fourth grade, and all they did was read to them an hour a day. And then they dropped them right into a public school environment, and within a semester, they were completely caught up and ahead. One of the reasons they believe was self-esteem, that they got that belief in themselves from their mom or dad who spent the time reading to them. And the second, books learn. Read to your children. Read out loud to them. I mean, from the you bring that baby home from the hospital, sit down by their crib and read to them. I don't care if they're asleep. I read to my kids while they're asleep. Before my wife held Josh, I was reading scripture to him. He had to go into the intensive care for a little bit. She was locked up in the delivery room or wherever they had her. I held him first, and I'm quoting Bible verses to him. And look how that turned out. Big, big messed up life. Reading. You cannot overemphasize reading to your child. And if you're going to read, then you want your child to become a reader. Give your kids books. And picture books. Give them all. My kids each have their own library, starting from when they're little. It's their library. Bigger and bigger and bigger. And when they move out, we have boxes of books. And Josiah's got 3 or 4 boxes in storage, little kid books, and then books on the bookshelf at home. But if you're going to have your kid be a reader, you got to shut the TV off. Because you can't compete with TV. You just can't. Simple thing. Shut off the TV. Put books in the kid's hand. You see, if a child is familiar with words, it won't scare them. If a child's familiar with, if they spend their whole life with books, I mean, they start with Dr. Seuss and work their way up to Hardy Boys or whatever you want to give them, and they read and they realize reading is fun, then the teacher says, I need you to read this chapter. They don't care. They devour it. kids ought to love reading. And you're going to have to shut off the technology. You're going to have to shut off. And by the way, I've given it out, and on occasion I'll hand it out to people, that the CEOs of Microsoft and Apple and Facebook and these giant media moguls, they'll tell you, they did not allow their children to even own technical devices. Never. And those who did, the rule was never in your bedroom. They'd limit what time to only educational time. I mean, the people who invented the tablet I'm looking at would not let their children have one. Because technology eats up a kid's brain and their time. We don't, I'm sending my kid to this school. All the kids in the school have a tablet. You check out the tablets, what they're used for. If you travel, I don't travel a lot, but when I travel, I walk up the plane, and all these businessmen with their laptops and their tablets, you know what I see most? Games. You know what I see next? Movies. I mean, on a whole plane, I might see one guy that it looks like he's doing something related to his job. And I'm not against technology. I use it all the time. But games are not an aid. They're not a help. You want children to excel academically. We've got to guard that. Look, we have this little window of time from birth until they're 16, 18 years old. It is gone in an instant. And you ought to watch every hour. If you're going to watch TV, plan it. Pick out what you want to watch. You want to watch a ball game? We did not have cable in our house. If we were going to watch a ball game, we'd go to my mom and dad's. They weren't in danger of TV messing them up. And so Josiah goes off to college, our last child gone, and I thought, he's coming home for Thanksgiving and Christmas. And so I had him bring cable so we could watch football, because now he's in college, and I don't care if he becomes an idiot. But guard your children. Let's pray. Father, bless us. Help us raise our children. Those of us that are older, our kids raised, may we be a good example to the children. May we pray for our young people. I pray we'd finance the Christian school and more private schools for these young people who attend our church. I'd love to have that school over on Lemon Street, Lord, if you'd bring the means to be able to do that, to put more kids in good Christian education for the sake of our nation, for the sake of the mission field, for the sake of the gospel being preached to the world. We need our young people. Would you help us? Bless our families here. Every family's different. Everybody's got different personalities, different backgrounds. Guide us, we pray, as we raise these our own and influence others here at our church for Christ. In Jesus' name.